Welcome to another edition of the Doubleheader. I'm Hari Sreenivasan with Mark Shields, David Brooks. This is where we talk about the sport of politics and the politics of sport. And today we even have the very high-tech, low-tech microphone that you'll see in the shop, but we're good with that. So, yes, that's right. Hello. So, that said, the sport of politics, this is the week that in Washington you saw a lot of people smoking marijuana under the Space Needle. They were celebrating the fact that...
State of Washington.
State of Washington.
I'm sorry.
Not,
state of Washington.
Not here in the nation's capital.
No, yeah, Space Needle, a whole different kind of Washington.
No,
so,
no, that's the House caucus, yeah, the House dining room.
Right. Three states now have it legalized, but through the voters, right? So now the Obama administration and the Justice Department are saying, wait a minute, it's still against the law federally. What should we do about it? What should they do about it?
I don't know. I mean, I assume federal law prevails. That's the deal, isn't it?
And in Colorado, Governor Hickenlooper is being pretty tough on this. Although I read somewhere that in the state of Colorado, there are more medical marijuana stores
than Starbucks and McDonald's combined.
Can that possibly be true?
No. It isn't.
Well, no. Actually, there's a lot of these little clinics that are actual clinics that you have to have a slip and what have you. And there was a... I remember seeing a
you
long...
You get the slip at Starbucks?
At 60 Minutes piece that was fascinating about it, too. But... is this going to come to a clash? I mean, these states, are these voters going to be overturned?
The
will of these voters? Yes,
I believe they will be. I mean, it's not a new thing that voters' wills are overturned. It happens constantly. But the longer-term issue is marijuana. How do we think about it?
Yeah.
You know, the number of people who are supporting it is rising. It's one of these, also a generational thing.
It is.
I saw a study, if they randomly pull drivers in California, do you see this, that 7% of them have traces of whatever drug it is in their system.
THC. Really?
Wow.
And so
7%.
That doesn't mean they're out of their minds. Apparently you keep it in your body for 24 hours or something like that. But that means there's a lot of usage going on.
In California. Of the people who drive.
Now, there's two factors here. There's a historical precedent. During Prohibition, when alcohol was, there was always the medical exemption. If you had a prescription, a doctor's prescription, you could get booze. All right, so you can see the expansion of the medical beachhead on marijuana. Plus, I think there is the brownie industry, which is a fairly formidable lobby,
right,
and they want to encourage the consumption of the entire munchie fast food.
The NRA, AIPAC, and Sara Lee
together
are the gigantic lobbies here.
Yeah.
The brownie lobbies.
Yeah. I mean, put the Girl Scout cookies right out of
there. Right in there.
Right
in there, too. Okay, that all said, I like how you figured out a way to connect the Girl Scouts to marijuana laws. The sport of politics of sport, the second section of the program. Let's talk RG3. You wanted to talk about it last week. He's doing fantastic. But the Redskins are, what, 6-6?
That doesn't matter. He is, as we call him here, Jesus in cleats. and he is like, he can do no wrong. I mean, Andrew Luck.
His magic trick fumble. What was that?
And he's fast. He's like, very fast people are chasing him.
Right.
And he's like running circles around them.
Right. He's got that going for him.
And so Andrew Luck is having a great season out at the Indianapolis Colts.
Yeah.
And he's bupkis. He's getting nothing because RG3 is Jesus.
Yeah.
Nobody's bupkis in Indianapolis. I'm sorry.
Okay. I don't know.
No. Okay.
But the interesting is Washington actually really cares about the Redskins.
Yeah.
And when there's glimmer of a scintilla of hope, this town goes straight to the Super Bowl. They go from complete despondency to the trophy is ours in a microsecond.
Two things about RG3. He's not only an All-American on the playing field, he's golden off the playing field. Who's ever counseling him or he's just doing himself is inspired. I mean, every move he's made is just golden.
Example,
I mean,
for those
He's got a wonderful touch. He's got an infectious smile. He's got a very natural manner. He's totally accessible. He goes to see the Washington Wizards.
When they beat the
worst team. I mean, they had a worse record than the Washington Generals are, who used to play against the Harlem Globetrotters, who lost 11 out of 1,614 games. But and so what do? They beat the Miami Heat, the defending world championship, with RG3 sitting in front of them. Second thing, though, in the caveat, and that is he's getting hit a lot.
Yeah.
And he's got a body that is not, he's not 6'4", 260.
Right.
I mean, he's not this enormous guy. And I'm just fearful that the way he runs, the way he is, he's going to be susceptible to serious injury.
One serious point, his fiscal cliff plan, the the RGIII luck bipartisan plan is, I thought, one of the best. The way they dealt with the entitlement issue was very
well, he's got entitlement to linebackers. I mean, which is something new inside
the
linebackers.
The Bugatti tax.
Yeah.
Right. Very nice.
But I actually wonder if football will be around for much longer.
Well, it's a good, and, it's a, and boy, I got to tell you, I mean, that BU study that was on this week on the NewsHour, I mean, the brains of these athletes.
I think it was 33 of 34 NFL players had damage to their brains like this, and then the neuroscientist that was on the NFL dime was saying, well, we still need more research.
Yeah.
And that was just one of those, it was almost like the climate change kind of stuff.
So, I would say the most likely outcome is that high school football diminishes greatly, but they find enough kids who are willing to do it. Who
or
need
Pop
the money
Warner.
Or,
I mean, we had this piece on from Stone Phillips. We'll link to that in the blog post. It's amazing how hard these little kids hit each other because they actually don't have any idea of how hard that force is. And their little bodies, they actually have bigger heads and bodies, and they're disproportional, and they just slam into each other with these helmets, and they think that's, you know, fun. And anyway, Notre Dame. Oh, Heisman picks for this weekend, because this will be on
Monte
Friday.
Monte Teo. Notre Dame linebacker, winner of the Nagurski Award, the Chuck Bednarik Award. Already the offensive line. The Heisman Trophy is this. But it's always gone to an offensive player and quarterbacks most regularly and uninterruptedly. The idea of a complete defensive player getting it, which would be aberrational, wonderful, original, inspired. He is a Hawaiian who came to Notre Dame, one of the two Catholic universities in Division I football, Boston College being the other, and he's a practicing Mormon. So it's
Hawaiian
kind of
a practicing Mormon at a Catholic institution.
At Notre Dame, So, and about to be the Heisman Trophy winner.
Okay.
Only in America could it happen.
Your pick?
I actually don't know any of the other three. That was the only one of the.
What about that kid, Johnny Football?
Johnny Football.
Johnny Football, he's a freshman, right? So,
he's a freshman.
I'm going with Mitch Ewald, who is the kicker for Indiana University and a close friend of my son.
But
having a very good year. Very good year at Indiana.
Completely unbiased. That's what
we like. You know
what?
They asked him, they said, how you feeling, Mitch? He said, I can't kick.
All right, so that's it for the doubleheader. We went a little long on sports today, but that's all right. This is Friday night. Enjoy yourselves. You'll see these guys go toe-to-toe downstairs in the big show.
Toe-to-toe?
Yeah, whatever. Toe-to-toe. All right. I'm Hari Sreenivasan, Mark Shields, David Brooks. Thanks for joining us.